It's a new month and you are welcome to another edition of BizTech on Ghana Web TV, where we serve you compelling interviews as well as interesting business headlines of the week. My name is Ernestina Sewa Asante. To begin with, my colleague Mauli Aholumega spoke with a tech entrepreneur and chief executive of electronic mobility company Solar Taxi. George Appiah takes us through his journey on the fast-growing manufacturing of electronic and solar-powered cars and motorbikes in Ghana. Enjoy the conversation.
E-mobility services are fast becoming the norm across the world. In Ghana, solar energy is being used as one of the models to spearhead tech entrepreneurs and their various initiatives. On today's edition of BizTech, I'll be speaking to a tech entrepreneur. He's the chief executive officer of e-mobility service Solar Taxi. His name is George Appiah. Join me and I'll introduce him shortly. Welcome back to BizTech on Ghana Web TV. George, good afternoon. How are you?
Good afternoon. I'm doing great.
Thank you so much for allowing us into your office.
All right.
It's quite
it's
a nice
pleasure.
Edifice here.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can you take us through the journey, what you do here, and just briefly explain to us what an e-mobility service is?
Okay, so Solar Taxi is an e-mobility company that we could also say a transportation service provider. So we provide through the entire spectrum, that is either the up down spectrum. So we are assemblers of electric vehicles and then also provide transportation services through these electric vehicles. So in assembling, we assemble both electric bikes. You can see some behind us. We also work on assembling tricycle. We do assemble cars, but in a very semi knockdown mode. But we are looking at having a bigger plant to do a full assembly, complete knockdown assembling of cars, electric cars for now. So that has to be the upstream part, and then the downstream is the services that we provide. So we have a model that provide rental services for the cars or the bikes. So for the bikes, if you are a courier company, you're a business, you can rent the bikes if you can purchase through our service. And then if you are an individual, also you can also get rent the cars and use monthly basis actually. So those are the services, and we provide other aspect of it too, depending on what we are trying to achieve.
Right. But just to take us back briefly, what's preempted this whole idea of you coming up with such an initiative?
Well, so we started about 3 years ago, where we took interest in the electric vehicle revolution that was happening. So what we did then, we built our own electric car with low resource, if I should put it that way, but it worked. And then from there, we were able to get support to expand that. So we moved from building a prototype to now expanding it and looking at the business. This started in Kumasi, at Kumasi Hive. And then we were able to then achieve, we test the business, get a resource, then we scale to Accra, bringing the services here. But yeah, Accra has now been more of where we have been very active. But we are still based in Kumasi. We also have operations in Takoradi and Tamale. Yeah.
But in terms of the market share, I'm sure when you're setting up the company, you made some surveys. Was it a survey that you conducted?
Yeah, we did. We spent close to 8 months understanding the market.
Okay.
So we piloted different business models, different type of vehicles and services, and design a number of things. And out of that, we gather the data, and then we know, okay, what works, what doesn't work, what do we enter the market with, and what do we enter at a later stage with.
And what did you find in that survey?
Well, I mean, we had a strategy, and that is what we have been implementing for the past 2 years now. But one of the key things was that there was a ready market for what we are doing. But then we chose to enter first of all with the electric bikes because the market already exists in that high amount. Then we follow up with the electric cars, electric tricycles. Yes.
Yeah. But one would say we're still in Africa.
Yes.
We're still using petrol and diesel as a means of fueling our vehicles.
Yes.
We still struggle to get electricity. How did you go about coming up with such an initiative, and what was the process? Using the solar bit of it.
Yeah, yes, we do have in Africa we do have issue of power and all that, but the transportation is something that is critical to any economy. The affordability of it provide a lot of economic empowerment to a lot of people, because then they can easily move around and then they can do more and be more efficient and all that. So in terms of investing in the right transportation service, that is the must. The good thing about electric vehicle transportation is that it's affordable, it's cheap compared to the alternative, and also get to save the environment, which is also a big plus comparing it with the economic benefit. What we do, providing the electric vehicles, is you have the chance, you can have an on-vehicle solar system or off-vehicle solar system. An on-vehicle solar system will be where you have a solar panel on the vehicle. Okay. We'll show you a couple of it later on. And then on off vehicle is when we have a solar system outside there, but then you charge it as you are done using it. And this is, even though it's a new technology, it is easy to use here, because you can easily charge it from a 16 amp socket outlet in your house, like the ones that you find in the kitchen or your garage. We can do 13 amps, but you shouldn't do them because then they burn your socket though. And also we can install dedicated chargers for you in the house. So it is ready to be used. It's not something that Africa has to wait or Ghana has to wait for 10 years from now. Not to that. And the honest truth is that it is far cheaper to use electric energy here in Ghana. Ghana actually even has a issue of high capacity, and then demand is still low. So electric vehicle is the way to go.
Yeah, but did you have to go to the Environmental Protection Agency? Because I know before you come up with these things, you have to go to the right agencies. What was the process like with that?
So currently, with the assembly that we do, I think we all our certifications, I think the Ghana Standard Board, and we get all of them at the port for the parts that we have to assemble and all that. But because it's an assembly, we don't need to work on those things here. But as we put up our factory, yes, that is part of the engagement that we have already begun, going to the EPA to get the licenses and stuff like that.
Okay, so on the factory, we see
The ark. So this is the ark. So the ark is basically, it's just like the Noah ark, right?
Yes.
So it took people from a different world to a new world, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So the ark here is taking us from the four base world, the petrol and the diesel world, to a new world of green transportation. Yeah, so that's why we call it the ark. So this is where the assembly takes place. Yeah.
Okay, so on the ark,
as you rightly explained,
how many people work here on the ark?
So here is mainly for the engineers.
Okay.
We currently have 16 engineers. All of them are ladies.
Okay.
So all engineers are ladies. Yeah.
Any
reason why not? Yeah, because if you go to other engineering space or assembling plants, you'll find majority guys. So nobody asks them why. Any reason why you are all guys over here?
It's best to give the women a chance.
Yeah, so why not? They are competent to get the work done.
Yeah.
Yeah, so yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's
so I'm sure you purchase some of your raw materials. Are they locally made or you purchase them?
So currently we get a lot of our assembly part outside. I think what we are working on is improving upon the ratio of the local content.
Okay.
I think that is something that is needed, because this is, I mean, the electric cars or electric vehicles are the future, all right? And it will benefit us if we can increase our local content, so that we have a lot of economic value being created across the value chain for a lot of people. So that is something we are working towards too.
So in terms of manufacturing and productivity, at full throttle, how many of these motorbikes, for example, do you produce? And also the vehicle we saw out there, like the electric car, how many do you produce?
Currently, we don't have the conveyor belts here to move the parts to different stations. The stations are base carrier just in the stations. So with this manual production, we do three bikes a day. But if we get the conveyor belt and on the other machines that we need, which we are actually looking for investment for, we should be able to do 200 units a day. Okay. Yeah.
So, Joe, this is quite a very innovative venture that you have here.
Thank you.
And in terms of competitive advantage, because we have a lot of what we call the Okades on the market, in terms of your solar taxi, especially the motorbikes, what's the competitive advantage on the market for you?
Well, interestingly, on our upstream part, we don't classify them as competitors because basically we are producing the bikes. We supply to career companies, individuals that want to do this or cut out or delivery service and all that. We produce bike for them, so you just purchase it as you just go to any bike shop to purchase a bike. So they are not our competitors. Basically, our competitors will be anybody that is into maybe the assembling or the importation of diesel or petrol bikes. Those people will then be our competition in that regard. On our downstream, yes, we do provide some more transportation services, but we try to work with the existing ecosystem, the existing transportation ecosystem. That's what we do. So by doing that, it makes that we rather embrace partnership over just competition. But we do organize the competition. We know that, especially like with electric cars and all that, we know very soon we'll have direct, like, growing competition for that. And that is something that we know it is going to happen, though. But we have spent years doing our research on it. We understand the technology. We know how it works. We improve upon the design. We currently send our own designs for us to get the part for. So we are not depending on off-shelf design, no. So we are continuing, because it's been close to 3 years now. We are always going to iterate the design to improve upon, because whole work outside doesn't necessarily mean that's what will work over here. So by doing this, that is what helps us. And our advantage is that we have the team, we have the engineering team that enable us to do this. And that is something that I would say that put us a good place.
Okay. So now let's come to numbers. How many of these are on the market?
We currently have over 150 bikes on the market. We have 20 cars on the market. We are looking at increasing that. Our tricycle team, we are yet to go through that, but what we are currently working is more of piloting the tricycle one, so we don't have so many on the market. I think currently we have about close to 8, but different designs. Okay. That we are testing the market with to understand how the tricycle market works. Okay. But for the cars and then the bikes, we start with the bikes. That's why we have more numbers than the cars.
Okay, so when it comes to the motorbikes, do they have an app you use to manage it, and for the cars as well? If you can take us through.
The app is just basically for you to get basic information on. So for the career companies like this, they use our platform to know which of the bikes are assigned to them. They used to manage with their riders and stuff like that. And then for the car, you get basic information about your car, because for you to be able to either purchase or rent our car, you need to sign up. Now, when it's for the car, we provide free maintenance.
Okay.
All right. So you are renting or purchasing, we provide free maintenance. Okay. So we're able to schedule your maintenance time, when you come for maintenance and stuff like that. So that is what the app is doing. But going forward, we'll be increasing the functionality more on it. Yes.
Also on numbers, I know money is very important. How much do the bikes cost?
Well,
for the cars as well.
So it depends on the capacity you want the bike to be. So if you the bike can start from around 7,000 to 18,000.
Okay.
So if you are looking at doing something around 60 kilometers to around 200 kilometers, So that informs how much the car will cost. To put in perspective, 200 kilometers is close to driving somewhere, close to getting to Kumasi, all right? And then 60, just doing maybe a round trip to Tema and coming back,
okay,
probably will give you 50 kilometers and still have another 10 kilometers. So in perspective, so if depending on what or how far your operations is, how long do you want to move around and all that, then you can purchase which one suits you.
Mobility of the car. So if I, does it have to be fully charged before you use it? What's the capacity?
It doesn't necessarily. But you need to know which capacity of the vehicle that you have. If you have a 20 kilometers car, you know that you can do a full day without charging it. All right, because like I said, it's like literally going to Kumasi. All right, and that is a long trip.
Yeah.
All right, so if you are using it here in Accra and all that, you don't need to be bothered about it. If you are using the same applies to the cars. So depending on the capacity that you have. All right, that'll help you to know how far you can go and how far you can do your movement. So,
yeah.
So that is basically the capacity of the vehicle determines the movements that you can then do.
Yeah. So, George, in terms of government support, have you received any government support in a way? And in terms of partnerships, have you had anyone come in and say, hey, we like what you're doing, want to partner with you? If there are any, if you can share with us.
So yes, we have been in touch with the government.
Okay.
We have a conversation with the Energy Commission.
Okay.
We are looking for different. We are looking for some form of support. Our biggest challenge is definitely is going to be the taxes and the duties that we face on our the parts that we bring in for assembling. If we're able to get any form of support, we're able to cut down the price to close to about 30-40%.
Okay.
That which is wonderful. That means that we are then able to give a good pricing to our customers and able to facilitate the transition to electric vehicle, to green transportation. So that part is something we have been having a discussion on. As of now, nothing yet,
okay,
but we hope going forward we're able to engage with relevant government institutions that can then support our efforts in scaling up this in the country. In terms of partnership, I think we have had MasterCard Foundation,
okay,
been with us since day one. After our first prototype, they supported us throughout for us to test the market to the business model, helping us to scaling up, helping us to extend our operations. So MasterCard Foundation has been our key partner and our supporting partner in what we are doing.
Yeah. So you've been doing this for 3 years.
3 years,
that's quite some time. I mean, for a startup, a new company, bringing out a new venture.
Yes.
Have you had some challenges?
Lots.
What are some of those, and have you had some highs also as well?
So yes, we have been in touch with the government. We have a conversation with the Energy Commission. We are looking for different. We are looking for some form of support. Our biggest challenge is definitely is going to be the taxes and the duties that we face on our the parts that we bring in for assembling. If we're able to get any form of support, we're able to cut down the price to close to about 30-40%.
Okay.
That which is wonderful. That means that we are then able to give a good pricing to our customers and able to facilitate the transition to electric vehicle, to green transportation. So that part is something we have been having a discussion on. As of now, nothing yet,
okay,
but we hope going forward we're able to engage with relevant government institutions that can then support our efforts in scaling up this in the country. In terms of partnership, I think we have had MasterCard Foundation been with us since day one. After our first prototype, they supported us throughout for us to test the market to the business model, helping us to scaling up, helping us to extend our operations. So MasterCard Foundation has been our key partner and our supporting partner in what we are doing.
So you've been doing this for 3 years.
3 years,
that's quite some time. I mean, for a startup, a new company, bringing out a new venture.
Yes.
Have you had some challenges?
Lots.
What are some of those? And have you had some highs also as well?
Yes, yes. We have faced a lot of challenges. Once again, it's a new technology, especially even if not new to the world, it's new to our environment. So we have to really a lot to understand of how it works and how we get the best out of it. So I would say that we have been in a learning mode for this past 3 years, learning how to optimize this performance. So the technical challenges are there, day in and day out. We get a challenge here, there, this issue, and then all that. And we are continuously working on that. Our engineers are always on standby for any form of complaint that comes from our clients. We are there. We are there to fix it. So that is something that we face on the daily basis. On the business side too, new client base, people are not sure of the technology and stuff like that. So what about if I'm using it and I get stuck on the road? What about if we race, will it stop? So we have all these issues that comes up. But I think gradually the early adapters that are working with us are getting to understand how the technology works. So business is shifting. We have to say we have a number of queer companies that we're also working with, supplying them with the bikes. So it is getting better on that. But the challenge has always been there. Even the human resources, we don't have people that already know this. So we have to train everybody from the scratch. So that even to market it, you need to know what it is. To be an engineer, you need to know how to work on this. So that is also a huge challenge. That's a big, big challenge that we face on that. But yeah, the challenge do exist. But we are working our way towards overcoming it.
3 years in still. I'm sure are you grooming anyone to take over any mentorship programs for Solar Taxi for some of your workers here?
So Solar Taxi, currently we have a team size of about 64 across the four places: Accra, Kumasi, Takoradi, the Tamale. The average age of our staff is about 23. And majority, this is their first job. So mentorship and capacity building is something that is an integral part of what we do. And as was mentioned, there's a new technology. People don't really have this. So you have to take anybody, you have to train them. Even the riders, we have to train them to understand how to use electric bike, because it's different from using a full bike and all that. So this is a key part of our destiny. We are building also our leadership team that are going to help take this into where we are going to get it to. So it is part of our core program. Training, capacity building, mentorship is part of what we do.
So COVID and tech. How's the impact been on the business?
For the COVID part, we had a lot of demand for e-commerce, and also then demand for courier service, and then demand for bikes, supplying of the bikes and stuff like that. So that is something that when it came, it came as unplanned though. But then we have to then wrap up our preparations and see that we can provide a number of bikes to our partners and that, because it's a growing e-commerce field that is resulting to the need of this bike. So yes, it did affect. So that was the positive side. The negative side is, yes, the point is, become difficult for a team to come around to work and all that. That affects us. The market uncertainties. We are working on raising funding, but now all funders were like, okay, I want to see before after COVID to see where I should put my money. Right, so discussion that you are having all of a sudden becomes slow and all that. So it makes things very, very difficult. The part of getting our part from overseas for assembling also became a big challenge, because logistics were disrupted. So things that you used to get for 30 days or 32 days, now it's taking you 60 days for you to get them. So that was a challenge.
Yeah, so now the borders are opened. Have you seen a spike in some of the products you bring in, and also the demand? Has there been a shift?
After lockdown, yes, it make it easy for us to come to work, for instance, so we're able to increase production. E-commerce has taken a good stage, and which also means that our electric bikes are needed by Korea companies and all that. So that is something that's, I think the post-COVID is helping with that. Over the world, post-COVID is also, we see a lot of increase in the need for green transportation across the world. So we hope that same form of transformation that's happening across the world also will also be witnessed here in Ghana.
So there we have it. We've been speaking to George Appiah, the chief executive of Solar Taxi, a Ghanaian-owned e-mobility service that deals with solar-powered electronic vehicles right here in Ghana. And it's very interesting to note that he has a team of able young women that are in the assembling plant coming up with very innovative and wonderful motorbikes and some of these vehicles that are already on the market. This is BizTech on Ghana Web TV. My name is Mauli Aholimega. See you another time.
That was really an interesting conversation with Mauli and George Appiah. Moving on, Jefferson, our friend from the tech world, is standing by with some internet tools that can assist us in our daily activities.
Hello there. My name is Jefferson Senyaja from Aftown Music. This week, I want us to continue from what we spoke about in the last episode. We spoke about Asana, a team collaborative tool that helps teams work effectively with tasks. I want for those of you that actually had a hard time with Asana, because it might seem a bit overwhelming and all so much over the place. A good alternative to Asana is called Trello. That is T-R-E-L-L-O. So just go to Trello.com and it's very easy. Trello allows you to work, and Trello is a great alternative to Asana because things are down to the lowest form and teams are easily able to join, and it's free. And the part that you would have a whole whiteboard and you'd be able to move tasks from one side to another, what's completed and what's not completed. Trello also gives the abilities for teams to actually work remotely, which is great for this time world now. So Trello, that's T-R-E-L-L-O, is a great alternative to keeping up with tasks, keeping up with schedules, and you can work with teams the size of 10, 12, 20, as much as you can go. So that's it for this week. I'll see you again next time. Bye for now.
The finance minister topped business headlines this week with his name emerging in issues regarding the Ijapa deal corruption assessment probe. Also, BOG warned customers of defunct fund management companies against paying facilitation fees to access locked up funds. Let's take a look at these and some other top business stories. Martin Amidu, the special prosecutor, has given notice of completion of a corruption risk assessment by his office into the controversial Ijapa royalties deal. According to his office, the process was concluded as far back as October 15 and had forwarded findings of same to the presidency and finance ministry on October 16. The office of the special prosecutor's probe raised concerns about suspected corruption with the deal. In August this year, the OSP, as part of its mandate, requested from the finance ministry documents regarding the special purpose vehicle, which helped the country secure about $1 billion to finance infrastructural projects. This followed criticisms from civil society organizations about red flags in the transaction. The minority in parliament has described the deal as one shrouded in secrecy, adding that its nature had the propensity to breed corruption, a position that government has strongly rejected. Away from that, President Akufo-Addo has terminated the appointment of Mr. Ejeni Mbuatin Ejei as Chief Executive Officer of the Public Procurement Authority. He has also been disqualified from holding public office for the next 5 years. This follows a report submitted to the President by the Commissioner of the Commission for Human Rights and Administrative Justice, Mr. Joseph Wutau, which concluded that on the totality of evidence, Mr. Ejeni Mbuatin had put himself in a position where his personal interests conflicted with the performance of his functions as CEO and board member of the PPA. The report further stated that he had abused his high office of trust. Meanwhile, the former PPA boss has also been suspended from the Ghana Institute of Procurement and Supply. The Securities and Exchange Commission has warned customers of the defunct fund management companies against paying facilitation fees to have access to their locked-up cash. This caution comes on the back of an entity called PBay Limited, purporting to be able to facilitate the payment of customer locked-up funds, but at a fee. A statement released by SEC described the action of PBay Limited as fraudulent, adding that it had not been registered by the Registrar General's Department. SEC called on customers to submit their claims and documentation to designated persons in accordance with statutory notices issued by the official liquidator or the SEC. It further said, anyone who disregards this warning does so at his or her own risk. Workers of the Tema Oil Refinery have given the president a one-week ultimatum to dissolve the board of the company. The staff say the board must be dissolved over its incompetent management of the refinery. The workers made the demand when they staged a peaceful protest on Wednesday, November 4, 2020, at the company's premises. Among other things, the workers say the board has made no significant contribution to the growth of the company. Meanwhile, the management of the Tema Oil Refinery Limited has described the call by the staff union as unfortunate. That's all from us today, but remember, you can get more stories on www.ghanaweb.com. Follow us on social media handles, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at the Ghana Web. Also, do well to follow us on Ghana Web TV on YouTube to watch all our programs. My name is Ernestina Sewa Asante. Have a great weekend.